It is definitely not enough. And is there any support coming from the local government, any counterpart assistance?
There will be augmentation definitely coming from the local government, Christian. But
magkano po?
This will be in kind in terms of food assistance. Secondly, Christian, we have this sustainable livelihood program in the city that we're giving with DSWD, of course, giving 20,000 for small enterprises. For example, mga karinderya, mga sari-sari store, we have identified around 6,000 to 7,000 beneficiaries for this purpose. It's a livelihood assistance, Christian. I think this is more important than the cash assistance. Cash assistance is on an interim basis. It's a stopgap measure. But when you give capitalization for small...
This is the Philippines. We are ANC.
Philippine senators slammed the latest incident of Chinese aggression in the West Philippine Sea. We'll be speaking to journalist Shara Zambrano, who was on a civilian Philippine vessel that was harassed by China's Coast Guard. Meanwhile, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken and Manila's top diplomat expressed concern over the continued presence of Chinese ships in Philippine waters. Vice President Lenny Robredo speaks out on the continued absence from the public eye of President Rodrigo Duterte amid the worsening health crisis. And more countries limiting the use or canceling orders for AstraZeneca's COVID-19 vaccine over side effect issues. We'll discuss that with Dr. Maria Consorcia Lim Quizon of the Health Department's National Immunization Technical Advisory Group. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Hey, thanks for joining us. And for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Philippine senators condemn the harassment of a Philippine vessel in the West Philippine Sea by the Chinese Coast Guard. We'll get to that later. But first, coronavirus deaths in the Philippines have reached a record high daily average of 117. The health department reported a total of 816 fatalities from April 2 to April 8. On April 6, the country logged the highest daily death toll since the start of the pandemic at 382. The total death toll breached the 14,000 mark on Thursday when the country confirmed over 9,200 new coronavirus infections. The number of active cases now stands at over 167,000. But the latest figures do not include results from five laboratories that failed to submit their data on time. The World Health Organization raising the alarm over the impact of the surge in COVID-19 cases on the Philippines' healthcare system. Details in this report.
The World Health Organization warns the Philippines is approaching a so-called red line in its healthcare capacity in handling the coronavirus pandemic. The WHO cites the high number of medical workers getting infected with the virus. When the line is crossed, it means the country's health care capacity has already been overwhelmed by the pandemic.
We are concerned about the situations in the Philippines. And once healthcare workers start to get infection, the healthcare capacity goes down. And ironically, that's the time more and more people need some help, but there is a consequence. And therefore, it's very, very important to avoid crossing this red line.
The WHO calls on the Philippine government to improve the country's healthcare capacity and boost contact tracing efforts. Reacting to the issue, Senator Francis Pangilinan calls on the global body to put the Philippines on the top of the list of beneficiaries in its COVAX facility and provide the COVID-19 vaccines needed to thwart the collapse of the country's healthcare system. The high bed occupancy rates has also partly forced the government to place Metro Manila and nearby provinces under stricter quarantine measures. Critics have also hit the government for the alleged slow rollout of the vaccines. Meanwhile, dozens of medical workers from the Visayas are already in Metro Manila to help treat COVID patients. Dr. Maricar Limpin, Vice President of the Philippine College of Physicians, says local government units play a key role in fighting the pandemic.
Ang malaking ano talaga dito will be the local government unit. Kasi di ba palagi sinasabi, ang naging problema kasi yung implementation, no, ng mga health protocols. Ang problema talaga will be doon sa local government unit. Kasi ang implementation ng program natin, nasa local government unit eh.
Two port-based quarantine facilities in the city of Manila and the province of Bataan set to open as COVID-19 treatment centers. These are the Eva Macapagal Super Terminal in Manila with a bed capacity of more than 200 and the Port of Capimpin quarantine facility in Orion, Bataan with over 120 beds and additional quarters for healthcare workers. These ports were originally used as quarantine facilities for returning seafarers and overseas Filipino workers. The Transport Department says the move will augment medical facilities as the COVID-19 surge continues to overwhelm many hospitals in Metro Manila and its surrounding provinces. Now, what steps should you take when a member of your household gets infected with the novel coronavirus? Our correspondent Jeff Canoy tells us what one survivor did and did not do in this report.
So you and your family have prepared to protect yourselves from COVID. But what happens when one member gets infected? Or worse, your entire household? What do you do? This is what COVID-19 survivor Cabby Rodriguez Alipio shared on her post on social media, which has gone viral. Last March, she tested positive for the new coronavirus, as well as her entire household.
Pero wala tayo sa mindset na, paano pag nangyari sa'yo, anong gagawin mo? This is your first aid, kumbaga, or your first response pag kami nag-positive. Para lang hindi aligaga, kasi we were like headless chickens at that time.
Alipio says it was her husband that first experienced symptoms and tested positive for the virus. When she and their two household helps also got tested, they also tested positive.
Nakakapanik. Yun, if there's one word, nakakapanik siya kasi parang hindi mo alam, are you infected na? Tapos biglang next question mo, what about the kids? What do we do about the kids? Do we give the, parang inisip ko, ang unang instinct ko, kailangan ko ba siyang dalhin sa parents ko? Kailangan ko ba dalhin yung kids ko to my parents, ihiwalay from us, para hindi sila mahawa? Pero at the second, parang second thought mo rin, ay, baka carrier na sila, di ba? Ayaw mo rin namang ma-infect yung parents mo. Siyempre, parents ko, seniors.
In hindsight, Alipio says, when one member feels any symptom related to COVID-19, it's important to isolate that member immediately, even if there's no test result yet. Assume that the member is infected and plan for a space in your home where that member can stay. Wear masks inside your home. They weren't able to do this back in March.
Meron siyang asthma eh. So parang combine mo yung asthma with COVID cough. Iba, parang yung buong diwa niya yung inuubo niya. I have a 6-year-old daughter, she understands. Diba? Parang, alam mo ba, unang tanong sa akin ng anak ko, Mom, am I gonna be an orphan? Diba? Parang, how do you answer that? In as much as you want to protect her, na huwag siyang magpanic, you really have to also tell her the truth. So, when she asked, is Dada okay? Eh, alam niya eh, na COVID is deadly eh. Parang, sabi ko lang, he's not okay. He's not okay. And Mama is also sick. Yun yung sinabi ko, I'm also sick. But my symptoms are not as bad as Dada's. You just have to be brave and pray a lot because I don't know what's gonna happen next.
Alipio adds it's important to have a checklist of things you might need, such as temperature guns, oximeters to check oxygen level and to know if it's time to go to the hospital, vitamins, medicine prescribed by doctors, fruits and vegetables and other sources for immunity boost, and disposable plates to throw out after meals. It's also important to prepare what she calls as a command center or list of relatives and friends who can help if the situation gets worse.
In my case, kumbaga, luckily, physically, I wasn't, di ako binugbog physically ng COVID, pero binugbog ako mentally and emotionally. So, halo-halo talaga siya. Parang, it's really hard. You have to realize that you will need to ask for help. Kasi hindi ka makakalabas eh. And the only way for people to help you is for you to communicate with them.
For now, Alipio's entire household has recovered from the disease. And she's hoping her experience can help others prepare in case it also happens to them. Jeff Canoy, ABS-CBN News.
Doctors who prescribe the anti-parasitic drug ivermectin to treat COVID-19 will be solely responsible if a patient will experience adverse effects. That's according to Dr. Edsel Salvania, director of the Institute of Molecular Biology and Biotechnology at the University of the Philippines in Manila. His statement comes after one hospital received a compassionate use permit from the Food and Drug Administration to use ivermectin as COVID-19 treatment.
Regulatory. So basically what that means is, first of all, we need to make sure that the source of the drug or the kind of ivermectin we're using is fit for human consumption. Second, the patient is aware that this drug is still not recommended. Third is that the doctor is taking full responsibility, meaning if something bad happens and the use was not justified, then the doctor can lose his license.
The FDA is still assessing whether it will allow the commercial use of ivermectin against COVID-19. Ivermectin is usually used to treat parasites in animals. AstraZeneca faces more woes over its vaccine against COVID-19. And as this report tells us, more countries are limiting the use of the jab, including here in the Philippines.
Australia and the Philippines limited the use of AstraZeneca's COVID-19 vaccine on Thursday, while the African Union dropped plans to buy the shot, dealing another blow to the company's hopes to deliver a vaccine for the world. The shot, which is developed with Oxford University and considered a frontrunner in the global vaccine race, has been plagued by safety concerns and supply problems since phase 3 trial results were published in December, with Indonesia the latest country forced to seek doses from other developers. The Philippines suspended the use of AstraZeneca shots for people below 60 after Europe's regulator said on Wednesday it found rare cases of blood clots among some adult recipients, although the vaccine's advantages still outweighed its risks. Australia recommended those under 50 get Pfizer's candidate in preference to AstraZeneca's, a policy shift that it warned would hold up its inoculation campaign. The African Union says it is now exploring options with Johnson & Johnson, having dropped plans to buy AstraZeneca's vaccine from India's Serum Institute. AstraZeneca's vaccine is by far the cheapest and most high-volume launched so far, and has none of the extreme refrigeration requirements of some other COVID-19 vaccines, making it likely to be the mainstay of many vaccination programs in the developing world. But more than a dozen countries have at one time suspended or partially suspended use of the shot, first on concerns about efficacy in older people, and now on worries about rare side effects in younger people. That, coupled with production setbacks, will delay the rollout of vaccines across the globe as governments scramble to find alternatives.
And for more on AstraZeneca's woes over side effects in its COVID-19 vaccine, we're joined by Dr. Maria Consorcia Lim Quezon. She's a member of the Health Department's National Immunization Technical Advisory Group, or NITAG. Dr. Lim Quezon, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us today.
Likewise, Carmina, and good afternoon, everybody.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm perfectly safe trying to just stay inside the house.
That's good to hear. Let's begin our discussion. I want to know what your opinion is regarding the suspension that was called by the FDA yesterday, suspending the administering of AstraZeneca on people or senior citizens people aged 60 and below. Go ahead, doctor.
Below. Right. Okay. So, the most important thing to understand here is it's an entirely precautionary measure. The FDA and DOH wants to keep us safe in the light of so many countries reporting this serious adverse effect. Although even in those countries, that this reported adverse effect is few and far between. So it's a precautionary measure, and so far to date, there is no documented case reported in the Philippines. So the FDA and the DOH said they needed 2 weeks to look again at the reports, at the data available, and hopefully we'll be able to lift the suspension after 2 weeks.
What might be the reason of the FDA for suspending the use of it on people 60 and below? Because when you look at other countries, their decision was to limit the use on people 30 and below.
There are countries that say 30 and below, 40 and below, 50 and below, as usual. Not as usual, but I mean, I think we're being overreactive in a good way that we say 60 and below so that we are protected.
All right. Now, explain this to us. What makes the age group of 60 and below more vulnerable to the severe side effect of having rare blood clots in the brain? If you could explain that to us, please, doctor.
Well, that is the description of the people who have experienced this in the documented cases abroad are within this age group, you know, and many of them are females. They haven't really explained the pathophysiology or why it is particular to this age group and why in some countries it is more the females rather than males. So we will just have to wait for the results of the studies done in other countries.
Is it possible also that the FDA will qualify its suspension to include that females should also be excluded? Not just, you know, people, but there's more emphasis on females, doctor.
Well, I think, as I said, we're being overreactive and being more protective by saying everybody na lang. You know, not just qualifying only for females until we are really sure that there is no causality. I have to explain that even even abroad, you know, they have not directly linked causality. Causality means, have you not given that vaccine, that person would not have suffered whatever side effect. Okay, because there are many cases wherein, whether or not you give the vaccine, that person could have had developed that disease.
Right.
So the experts are looking for that causality, the direct link. When we say we can prove without reasonable doubt that is in fact the cause.
But our situation right now all over the world, Dr. Lim Kee-sun, is that we're racing against time. We do want to vaccinate as many people as possible to determine the causality. How long might that take before, you know, things are clear and the suspensions are lifted? What do you think?
You know, the thing is, the number one issue here, which is beyond our control, at least here in the Philippines, is where are the vaccines? Where are the doses? You know, even if you want to race against time, even if we are, let's say, okay, let's go ahead. The benefits far outweigh the risk. Let's just go ahead and vaccinate people. But the arrival of the vaccines are few and far between. And I understand that this is being addressed by WHO in asking for equity in the distribution of the vaccines.
Well, so even if...
I mean, you pointed out a very obvious thing there. Even if, you know, they determine the causality, and if the vaccines are not here with us yet, I mean, you know, we're in a bit of a pickle there. So
I know.
So I want to ask you this, right? You have safety concerns. You also have supply problems. But it's very important to reiterate that despite all these, vaccination is still imperative. But what are now, considering all that, the way you see it, map it out for us, considering the vaccines that we have on hand, or at least the meager amount that we have, what are the, and those that are slated to come in, what are the recommendations now for which age group, just to give us a clearer picture of what should be administered to whom?
Okay, so right now we have two vaccines that are available in the Philippines. When I say available, you know, some have actually been used up already. Mm-hmm. But it is Sinovac and Astra that arrived, you know. So in the light of this suspension, it means that Astra can be given to those 60 and above, while Sinovac will be given to all ages. Because remember that we have just been given the go signal by the expert panel group that we can use the Sinovac for those above 60. Mm-hmm. So that's the situation now. We can use both Astra and Sinovac for those above 60, and for those below 59 and below, we will use Sinovac.
Let's get into because that. Go ahead, please.
No, go ahead, please.
Okay, no, I wanted to get into that decision of the FDA allowing the use of Sinovac on senior citizens. You know, that concerned a lot of people, that had a lot of people worried, because in the beginning, you know, people, experts were saying it's AstraZeneca for the seniors. You got to reserve AstraZeneca for the seniors, Sinovac for the rest of, you know, the population. So now people are worried. Is the FDA just accommodating, or is it really performing its function of being regulating the use? So I want to get your opinion on this. Maybe disabuse the minds of many as well, because I want to talk about the situation being dynamic, the situation being alive, and the call for and the need really for experts and scientists to determine the situation, assess the situation, and determine the action for the situation at hand. So map it out for us, Dr. Quizon. First, the question is, with that decision of the FDA, was it being accommodating rather than performing its function of regulating?
Well, if it's a regulatory board, it is regulatory, okay? There should be no compromise where that is concerned. Now, what we're talking about is that the experts who are reviewing, you know, let's go back a little, you know, a few months ago, January, February, before the first Sinovac first tranche arrived, you know, the experts need the available data from trials and what will be provided to them by the manufacturers in order to review and make their own decision regarding the safety and efficacy of the vaccine, okay? The availability of data, published and otherwise, in January is certainly different from now, March. As you said, it's so dynamic. It's a moving target. It's a work in progress, okay? So they have more data now than compared to, let's say, January. So we can actually reconsider some recommendations. Whereas before we said strictly for below 60, you know, because that was the available data. But when the expert panel revisited, they were able to extrapolate or make educated and very technical guess on guess is not exactly the right word. I don't know how to laymanize extrapolate, but yeah, they were able okay. to extrapolate that it can be used by 60 and above. And also, you know, with the experience from other countries like Indonesia and Brazil, they use it for people above 60. The only reason why initially we said let's be cautious about it is that in those countries there weren't enough. There were thousands upon thousands of old people getting the vaccine. Because mm-hmm. as you know, in any research, you don't usually include pregnant people and the old people. That's why Correct. There was limited data.
Correct. I guess the issue was just being muddled because of the FDA's also recent decision of, you know, giving or allowing compassionate use of another drug, ivermectin, to one hospital. Right. And then all these other decisions that the FDA has to make. So people are lumping it together and are concerned.
Doubting.
Yeah. Doubting. And you said it, not me. Yeah, about
it's written all over your face. You just don't want to say doubting. And but, I shouldn't have said it. But
it's
yeah.
all right. It's all right. But see, that's the concern. Yeah. That's the concern of people, right? Yeah. And it's understandable. Yeah. So that you take one decision of the FDA regarding one matter, and then you take another decision of the FDA regarding vaccination. And as you said, people begin to doubt the decision of the FDA. But
and
Go ahead.
And it's so hard. You know, there's vaccine hesitancy. People are clutching at straws. Actually, I think this whole ivermectin issue arose from the fact that people are thinking we are in dire straits and we really need to take something or do something. Mm-hmm. Even though with just the touch of a button, you know, you look at all available literature, WHO, US CDC, everybody says that really, there is no evidence that ivermectin works in all of the trials that they have done so far, mm-hmm. okay? So this compassionate use, whether it's to try, you know, and see. As Dr. Saldana said, it will be the responsible of the doctor. Mm-hmm. Okay, and what I see here is the operative word is hospital and doctors. And so it doesn't say anything definitely about it being prophylactic or worse to be used as self-medication. So mm-hmm. at least it will be in the hands of the hospital and the doctors.
Yeah, but you know, who's to say if another... another hospital will be allowed compassionate use after this one. I mean, that's you said putting the FDA in a difficult situation or in a bad picture, I should say. Before we go, we're running out of time, but I do want to ask you this: all these safety concerns, supply issues as well regarding AstraZeneca. Give it to us straight. How will this affect the vaccination rollout here in the Philippines?
It is affecting the vaccine rollout because we are ready. We have been asking the local government units to prepare and do their own discarte to roll it out. And yet, where are the vaccines? But unfortunately, I guess that's beyond the control of anybody. As I said, there are global forces working here. And so hopefully, we were told by the vaccine czar and the private sector that we are expecting it's trickling now, but hopefully come April, May, and June, there will be millions of doses coming in. So mm-hmm. we just have to hang on and continue to practice the basic precautionary measures that we've been doing for our own safety.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it at that. I'm sure I'm going to talk to you very soon again. Dr. Maria Consorcia Lim Quizon, a member of the DOH NITAG, thank you so much for joining us today. You keep safe, continue to keep safe, and thanks for all that you do.
Likewise, Carmina.
All right, and from there, another big story. Yesterday, and we're going to talk about it today, China steps up its aggression in the West Philippine Sea. The Chinese Coast Guard deployed two missile-capable ships to chase down a Filipino vessel carrying civilians, including ABS-CBN's news team. Our correspondent Shara Zambrano now joins us from Palawan. Shara, give us a lowdown.
Yes, Carmina, we've only just reached the mainland again after traveling several hours from sea. And by now, I'm sure you've already shown some of the footage that we've filmed while we were inside the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. Our intention in going to the West Philippine Sea was to see where Filipino fishermen are going now in terms of under the context of the swarm of Chinese fishing vessels that seem to already be scattered in the best fishing grounds, their old fishing grounds. If for sure, it has an effect on their lives and livelihood, and we wanted to know from themselves what these effects were. So that's why we set out to sea, and we went from shoal to shoal, reef to reef, trying to look for these Filipinos. And that's when we encountered first the Chinese Coast Guard ship, and then second, these very fast missile-capable attack craft coming from presumably Mischief Reef, which was just very close to Ayungan Shoal where we were trying to go. Now, from what I recall, Carmina, this is the first time that China has ever used a military, a People's Liberation Army Navy vessel against a civilian boat. At least this is the first recorded or documented incidence of it. But for sure, this is the first documented instance of these Hubei Type 22 missile fast attack craft being used in the West Philippine Sea area and against a Filipino civilian vessel inside the exclusive economic zone. It's important. This brings about a new dynamic in the West Philippine Sea, Carmina, because prior to this, from years ago, all of the incidents of harassment, of chasing, of blocking by China has been done against civilians using their what they call the white ships, the Chinese Coast Guard vessels, which was the first vessel that chased us yesterday. This is a strategy because these white vessels are civilian in nature. They use these against civilians, which effectively ties the hands of the Philippine military against them using their own Navy ships, because then perception-wise, it would look like the Philippines was the one escalating the tension by bringing warships into a civilian situation. But now it begs the question now begs to be asked how the armed forces of the Philippines or how the Philippine government can respond to this in case this isn't a one-off event, in case these missile boats have been stationed at Mischief Reef, which is the closest artificial island to mainland Philippines. How then do they respond to this? This is now a warship being used inside the exclusive economic zone on Filipino civilians. So it's an important question that needs to be asked, but certainly this is an escalation in terms of the tension between China and the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea, Carmina.
All right, Shara, I want to know what the Defense Department, your sources from the AFP, what are they saying about this?
Well, I haven't had a chance to talk to them yet, Carmina, because we only just got back to mainland Palawan a few hours ago, and it was a pretty long drive back to Puerto Princesa City, where I am now. But for sure, I will be going to them. I will be sharing notes and asking questions and see if for sure they will have something to share about this in order to give us a complete picture of the situation in the West Philippine Sea and hopefully where the Philippines is going to take this from here on, Carmina.
Yeah, because it makes one wonder, Shara. You were on a civilian vessel. Had you been on a military craft, would that have happened? I mean, it now opens a lot of possibilities, as you said.
There's a crucial moment that I remember, Carmina. This was when the China Coast Guard vessel first radioed the Filipino crew. They said it in English, so I understood it. They were asking the Filipino crew to identify themselves, why they were there, where they wanted to go. and I was interpreting their messages, their message to the crew, because the crew did say that they didn't speak English, nor could they understand it. And so the way they responded instead was to quickly steer the Filipino boat 100 degrees, and to kind of communicate that, okay, you don't want us to be here, we're turning back, we're going home. But this really exposes, Carmina, the problem of the language barrier. If China Coast Guard is requiring Filipino vessels to respond to their challenges and they can't understand them, what kind of effect, what kind of consequences will that be to the other Filipino fishermen who happen to be sailing in that area where we were? Will they encounter the same kinds of vessels that we encountered? And what would they feel, you know, being alone at sea in such, you know, wooden and small vessels compared to the metal and steel ones that we saw on the part of China?
And it was pretty obvious, Shatter, from the footage that you sent to the newsroom, that the language is very, very clear. It's a language of force that was very apparent in the footage and what you experienced yesterday.
Yeah, at some point, Carmina, they didn't even need to understand the words of what was being said on the radio. Just the way that the Chinese Coast Guard vessel very sharply turned and made a beeline directly to our direction, and the fact that this Chinese vessel chased us and followed us for an entire hour, only to be followed by two missile boats that followed us again for a good 20 minutes or another half hour. That message is clear enough that we weren't supposed to be where we were, at least in China's eyes. But by international law, Carmina, that was well within the Philippines' exclusive economic zone. And any Filipino vessel, whether military, civilian, cargo, or fishing, should be free to sail there and fish there for as long as they wish. Carmina.
All right. For sure, we're going to follow this story. We're glad that you're back safe on dry land. Our correspondent, Shara Zambrano, there joining us today from Palawan. Keep safe, Shara. Take care. And from there, we're going to take a break now. Up ahead, opposition lawmakers want more proof President Rodrigo Duterte is in good health. Plus, an update on the condition of former President Joseph Estrada. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving to the less fortunate folks.
When you think about the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school, they look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students.
Very often we know in conflict areas, the most of the population that has been affected is actually women and girls and all peoples. So to be able to reach out in some of these areas when it comes also to culture. You need to have women peacekeepers to actually be able to talk to people and getting what is going on in a society.
You're still with Dateline Philippines here on AMC. Senators condemn China's continued aggression against the Philippines. Senate President Vicente Soto III says the Foreign Affairs Department is already filing a protest against China's move. Soto adds maybe the time has come for Manila to review its treaties with Washington, which has expressed support for Manila. Senator Francis Pangilinan also says the Philippines should conduct joint patrols with the U.S. and Australia to assert our country's sovereignty. Senator Risa Ontiveros, meanwhile, said Beijing has resorted to violence to win its territorial dispute with the Philippines. Ontiveros urged the Duterte administration to denounce China's threats and intimidation. Meanwhile, the Philippines and the United States expressed shared concerns over the continued presence of Chinese militia vessels in Philippine waters. On Twitter, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken said he had a substantive discussion with his Filipino counterpart, Teodoro Loxin Jr., regarding the issue. Blinken also reaffirms the applicability of Manila and Washington's mutual defense treaty in the disputed waterway. Both he and Loxin call on China to abide by Manila's 2016 arbitral victory. A major move by the U.S. to push back China's expanding global influence, especially in the Indo-Pacific region. A sweeping bill introduced in the Senate on Thursday seeks to fund America's strategic initiatives to counteract Beijing by promoting human rights, providing security, and investing in combat disinformation. The Strategic Competition Act of 2021 wants a $655 million funding for the Indo-Pacific region's military from 2022 to 2026. It also recommends putting in $450 million for the region's maritime security initiatives. The bill also mandates Washington to encourage allies to do more about Beijing's aggressive behavior.
President Duterte pays tribute to COVID-19 frontliners and fallen soldiers as the country marks the Day of Valor. In a statement, Duterte lauded frontliners for showing fortitude and selflessness as the country battles the pandemic. The president also honored fallen soldiers. He says their sacrifice became the bedrock of Filipinos' resolve to uphold the country's liberties. The Day of Valor remembers Filipino and American soldiers who battled Japanese forces during World War II. The Makabayan Bloc in Congress tells President Duterte to show himself to the public to prove he is in good health. On Thursday, Duterte's longtime aide, Senator Christopher Bongo, shared what he claims were new photos of Duterte to refute speculations he is ill. But for Gabriela Representative Arlene Brosas, Malacañang can do more than show photos of the president. She wants the palace to urgently act on the worsening pandemic. Bayamuna Representative Eufemia Culiamat also says the public deserves to know about the true state of Duterte's health. Vice President Lenny Robredo agrees leaders should be visible in times of crisis.
Assurance na everything is under control. Mm-hmm. Kasi pag wala yung assurance na yun, Karen, yung tao, nasa stress siya eh. Parating yung ang tanong, saan na ba tayo papunta? Kaya pa ba natin? I think that's where that's where it is all coming from. Pero para sa akin, gaya sa amin, rather than spend a lot of time looking for this and that, gagawin na lang namin yung kaya namin gawin kasi kailangan ng tao.
Speculations on Duterte's health arose when he canceled his weekly address last Wednesday after dozens of members of his security group contracted COVID-19. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque says Duterte will address the public next week. The mismanagement in the distribution of financial assistance in parts of the NCR Plus bubble shows local government units did not learn from last year's lockdown. That's according to Bayamuna Party List Representative Carlos Zarate. Aside from the lack of preparedness of LGUs, Zarate says what's really causing the frenzy among the public is the meager 1,000 peso per individual aid. He says each family should have been given 10,000 pesos to tide them through the two-week enhanced community quarantine.
This is the real litmus case for the Duterte administration. Ano ba dapat i-prioritize talaga nila? The government is saying we will just continue with our build, no? Ang sinasabi na namin noon, pwede namang i-realign yan. For our 2021 budget of 4.5 trillion, almost 1.2 trillion ay nasa infra. Yesterday, I heard a local LGU executive saying na so that they can effectively respond to this problem, they will have to realign some of their infra projects and prioritize COVID-19 interventions. So why not the government can do that?
Vice President Lenny Robredo's office has launched a free teleconsultation service to help decongest hospitals. Robredo says they have around 2,300 volunteers already, 500 of whom are doctors. She notes it is accessible to anyone, even those with no internet access, as the initiative is conducted through free mobile data.
Yung role, Karen, meron kaming mga prompts. We have questions which would determine whether or not the patient would need emergency care. Kasi okay. Yung pinaka-concept ng teleconsulta namin for outpatients. Mm-mm. Ito yung mga outpatient na won't need to go to the hospital but would need to talk to a doctor for medical advice. Pero when the doctor deems it necessary that this particular patient needs to be seen in a hospital or needs hospital confinement, we have another team na sumasalo.
I see.
Yung team okay. Na sumasalo. And Karen, yun yung aming problema. Operate parang under the protocols that we have. Kaya kami, yung mga kailangan dalhin sa ospital, kami yung nagko-contact sa One Hospital Command.
Robredo also says the launch of their swab cab initiative has been successful, but she says they need partnerships with local government units before it can be brought to other areas.
That's why we have received a lot of requests already for the swab cab. Pero yeah, we need partnership with the LGU kasi we have a lot of limitations. Yung pinaka first step, Karen, yung LGU will identify who will be swabbed. Kasi hindi naman namin alam yung area. Diba? Okay. Hindi namin alam yung area. So, ang mga pinapadala nila, those with symptoms, those who were contact traced.
Former Philippine President Joseph Estrada's condition steadily improving. His son, former Senator Jinggoy Estrada, says his father seems to be responding well to treatment. He adds doctors are starting to slowly wean the former president off ventilator support. The former president was hospitalized after testing positive for COVID-19. News overseas now. New Zealand temporarily bans the entry of all travelers from India, including its own citizens, following a high number of positive coronavirus cases arriving from the South Asian country. Details in this report.
New Zealand has temporarily banned all travelers from India after a surge of imported COVID-19 cases from the country. The move comes after New Zealand recorded 23 new coronavirus cases on Thursday, 17 of which were from India. New Zealand had virtually eliminated the virus from its borders and hasn't reported local transmissions for over a month. Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern announced the ban Thursday, which will apply to anyone who has been in India over the past 2 weeks. The first time such a ban will include New Zealanders as well.
This will take effect from 4 p.m. on the 11th of April, this Sunday. That allows us time to draft the legal orders that will be required. This temporary suspension will remain in place till the 28th of April.
India has reported nearly 13 million cases of COVID-19, the third highest tally in the world after the United States and Brazil, and it's currently battling an even harsher second wave of the disease. New Zealand has implemented testing requirements to reduce the number of imported COVID-19 cases, but Ardern added that has not helped with the surge from India. New Zealand also reported one new locally infected case on Thursday, an employee at a coronavirus isolation facility.
Businessmen in the Philippines grew more upbeat over their prospects in the next 12 months. Based on the Philippine Central Bank's latest business expectations survey, the confidence index of businessmen rose to 60.5% during the first quarter of 2021 from the previous quarter's 57.7%. This was attributed to the easing of quarantine measures, the reopening of establishments at the beginning of the year, the rollout of COVID-19 vaccines and the development of new business or marketing strategies amid the new normal. The survey, however, was conducted before the government reimposed the enhanced community quarantine over Metro Manila and nearby provinces. Still, the BSP says it's too early to tell whether the lockdown will drag down sentiment. The Philippine Central Bank keeps its ceiling rate for credit card charges to help ease the burden of consumers as the pandemic rages on. The annual interest rate remains at 24% or 2% per month. The monthly add-on rates for installment loans were also retained at 1%, while the maximum processing fee was kept at 200 pesos per transaction. The central bank says billings and credit card applications increased last year. It adds retaining a low credit card interest rate is in line with its goal to keep a low interest rate environment. The central bank has kept its policy rate at a record low of 2% to boost the economy. On to some sports action before we go. The Chicago Bulls, well, they continue to make a late charge for a playoff spot. Nikola Vucevic and Zach Levinich scored 22 points in the Bulls 22 to make that 122-113 victory against the Toronto Raptors. Chris Boucher scored a career-high 38 points and grabbed 19 rebounds for the Raptors, who have lost 15 of the last 8 team games. Chicago improved to 22-28, climbing to 10th place in the Eastern Conference. In Dallas, the Mavericks defeated the Milwaukee Bucks 116-101. Dallas's dynamic duo of Luka Doncic and Kristaps Porzingis scored at will against the Bucks. Doncic flirted with a triple-double while Porzingis added 26 points and 17 rebounds. It was a good bounce-back win for Dallas, which lost the other night to the lottery-bound Houston Rockets. The Mavericks are currently ninth in the Western Conference. And that'll do it for today. Thanks for keeping us company the whole week this week. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines Podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Playback this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe, you guys. Keep it here on ANC. We'll be right back.